Hello, this is Peaceful Anarchism on the Voluntary Virtues Network every Thursday at 1 p.m. And you can also find me on the Conscious Resistance Network and Conscious Resistance YouTube channel. So today we have Mason Moore, who is an anarchist rapper from Oklahoma. And he's been putting out a few liberty-minded rapping albums lately, and he's getting more into the anarcho-capitalist slant, so we can always use more liberty-minded musicians. So Mason, tell us a little bit about how you got into anarchy and how you got into rapping, I guess.
Sure. Well, thanks for having me on, Danny. I appreciate it a lot. That's cool. It all started probably like a lot of people back in 07 during Ron Paul's first campaign. We were just turned 18 and I was interested in politics and stuff. And I was watching the debates and I was assuming that I was going to be supporting a Democrat because, I'd spent all my teenage years during the Bush era where, I thought Republicans were pro-war and the other side wasn't. And I remember I watched a Republican debate. I wasn't even sure why I did it. But there was this crazy old guy in the corner that just, every time they let him talk, which they didn't very much, he was just spitting his truth. And I was like, damn, this guy's talking some shit right now. Can I cuss? I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's fine. No problem.
And afterward, I got on Wikipedia or whatever and looked him up immediately, and I saw that he ran as a libertarian in 1988. So I automatically went to libertarian and found out what that was about. And, But you know what happened from there. I just learned more and more about the message. I've read all I could about it. Supported his campaign a lot. Tried to spread the message. And as time went on, the 2008 campaign happened in 2012. And probably leading into the 2012, I was familiar with, taking the next step of the progression of the thought process of liberty and Austrian economics and all that and taking it into anarcho-capitalism, which is the logical conclusion, I think. I remember the moment that I decided that I actually hit me. It's like, duh, this is like anarchism is the solution. It's the final product of the thought. Was I was watching a Kokesh show. He had Stefan Molyneux and Jeffrey Tucker on. We were talking about IP rights. And growing up in the 2000s, everybody was kind of familiar with Napster and the idea of IP rights and how and through that they're looking at it through the lens of music and the entertainment industry, and they were just talking about how the government enforcing IP rights restricts invention and how nobody can own an idea, and these are all stuff that I already heard about, but talking about it through the perspective of anarchy. And at that moment, everything just came together, and I was like, oh, duh, this makes sense. And I think with the words Jeffrey Tucker said, that really turned over. It was like, we don't want the government to do anything. Anything we do is awful. And the most important things we have are courts and security. Like, those are the two most important things. So why would we leave the government in charge of them? It just doesn't make any sense. So that was the moment I decided to be an anarchist. It was probably in 2012, but yeah.
So what books have influenced you the most?
The first books I read were Ron Paul stuff, and in 2007 in his campaign in 07, when he made Peter Schiff his economic campaign, I saw Peter Schiff's name and I read him, read all his stuff. And then obviously I made the advance of reading Rothbard and all that. Although you said book, I have one book on right here that I've been reading. Everybody's probably read it, but is that in reverse? How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie. And I think that's an awesome book for any anarchist or anyone that wants to spread the ideas of liberty. Because if we want to make the world a better place, we have to share these ideas. We can't just talk to each other all the time. Mm-hmm. And that's really what I try to do.
Mm-hmm. So how long you've been rapping?
Oh, forever. I was doing it and all the way through high school and all that. And I started to get serious at 21. I was like, I'm gonna be rapping a show. All my music was not is not liberty themed. I mean, obviously it comes through in most stuff. Yeah, when I was about 21, I decided to go for it, and I recorded a whole lot of music. I continued doing it for a few years, and I slowed down quite a bit last couple. But the last two songs that I put out were songs like Ancap Rat. It's on YouTube, and I'll share all my links to my stuff with you later. Or you can follow me on Twitter at MamoN1LH. It's MAMONLH. Mamo is kind of my other name I use. And all my links to all my social media and my SoundCloud are there, and you can go and listen and download all my stuff. But Ancap Rap, and I got a really good feedback from people from that. So when Luna hit me up, a couple months ago or whatever, and we made that track, and we got an awesome feedback from that, and he did an awesome job with the video, so I'm gonna focus on that for a while because people seem to like it, so I'm gonna keep doing it.
Mm-hmm. You mean liberty-minded rapping, yeah, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely. I think that the time is ripe for that kind of music. I think the people are receptive to it. Right, I think people want something different, right? So you gotta strike when the moment is right, right? When the opportunity presents itself. So
yeah, exactly. And I just do it because it's fun, and people seem to like it, and it gives me the opportunity. Like, I'm here because I made rap music, and I love to talk about liberty, and it's created this opportunity. So I'm gonna keep doing it.
So as a rapper, I guess as a musician in general. I talk a lot about intellectual property, with people because some people they get caught up in that, like, how can you be a rapper or any kind of musician and not have IP and not force people to buy your stuff, and how can you offer it for free, So what do you say to those people?
That argument is completely ridiculous to start with. Because as a musician, you want as many people to be exposed to your music as possible, if you're making good music. If you're making good music and you want people to hear it, then more people will like you, and let's tell other people about it, and you want them to share. The best, whenever I have this argument with people, the best example I give is when Lil Wayne became extremely popular in, like, the 05, 06, 07, like, when his rise to, like, being the incredible superstar he became. It was because he made these mixtapes, and they were free to download off the internet, and that's literally, and everybody shared them and everything, half the time he was rapping over other people's beats, and that's what made his music spread, and that's what made him grow to be number one. And as far as, like, how do you make money off it, and where's the motivation to be a creator, I mean, you make money other ways. You make money from performing, number one. Or if you become big, you brand yourself, and you use yourself to, sell other products, sell real property, not, intellectual property is kind of oxymoronic because it's not property. It's not, if it's not a scarce resource, it's not property. It's infinitely replicatable.
Nice. Yeah. And also, like, how can you, patent an idea or, like a form? Like, can you patent a square or a rectangle or a triangle?
Who has the patent for the wheel? Like everything has wheels in it. Like, it's ridiculous. All technology is built upon older technology.
Yeah.
And the argument that nobody has the motivation to create if they can't own with their creation, it just doesn't make sense. For example, like movies, like the companies that make movies, like, big entertainment industry. They're perfectly capable of protecting their movies and having them not leak. Like, now movies don't even get online from while they're in theaters for a couple weeks on the Pirate Bay or whatever. Mm-hmm. They are really good at keeping secrets, basically. And that's how creators have to do it. They just have to keep secrets. And obviously there's a lot of structure in place that makes it hard for people to comprehend this a change happening. Like, it's not going to happen overnight. You have to roll back the laws slowly. Mm-hmm. But it's completely, it's crony capitalism in its best. It's people in power. They're trying to accumulate more wealth, and they're the ones that created these laws to protect themselves, allow you to create all this stuff that protects them, and that's it.
Yeah.
When it comes to intellectual property debate, something interesting that happened recently was Taylor Swift took her music off Spotify, off the streaming stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's lots of different arguments either way. But Taylor Swift is okay to do that because everyone knows who Taylor Swift is already. There's not that big of an audience she could still reach out to that she hasn't already. So it's cool for her to do that. Like, whatever. But that's not going to work for 99.999% of other artists. Like, that model wouldn't work. They want their music streamed. They want as many people to hear their stuff as possible.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. And I remember hearing about a story about, you know Monty Python, those, the British comedian group? They have their old movies, right? And so I guess people were starting to upload some of their, the content onto YouTube, and then YouTube kept deleting. I guess some people would flag it, as copyright violation, and then they would delete it, right? And then finally, people stopped flagging it, and then they just allowed people to upload, these segments. And so what ended up happening was the younger people that didn't grow up with Monty Python, never heard of them, actually became interested, and then after they became, their sales went up,
yeah,
skyrocketed because they found out about Monty Python through,
yeah,
YouTube, right?
And that never would have happened if people didn't share it.
Yeah.
That's just an example of what, I mean, at the root of all this, the whole reason we're even, the message of liberty has spread this much, and that entertainment has become this, is because of the internet, just as a whole, because people have this ability to communicate with each other. And then, about 20 years ago, that, music and video were not thought of a non-scarce resource, it was something you had to have. And it's just a beautiful thing that technology is creating this, and this world that we live in, this environment where information can be spread so easily.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also intellectual property, the way I look at it is, it's like you're living in the past. It's like you have one song, right? And it's like a hit, and so you quickly patent it or whatever, or copyright it, and then anybody else who tries to play without giving you a royalty, you track them down, each and every person, and you prosecute them, and you get whatever money you can out of them at the expense of future creativity, right? Because time is a scarce resource, right? We all have limited amounts of time. So when you devote that time to the past, you're sacrificing the future. Yeah, that's kind of the way I look at it. So
that's an interesting, absolutely.
It's like those those one hit wonders that you find, right?
Yeah. They're complete manufactured by the entertainment industry complex that, just through marketing that made the stuff popular, and the people that write the music and all that stuff. Yeah, and they just try to hold on and they just try to make the money off them every penny they can. Absolutely.
Yeah, like there's a rapper I remember, when was that? Like maybe like close to 10 years ago, I guess. Mike Jones, are you familiar with him?
Who? Mike Jones?
Yeah, there you go.
Yes.
would you say that's an example of a one-hit wonder? Because that guy...
He had quite a bit of underground buzz, I think.
Okay, because that's basically, his biggest, song, right? That one and... The one about the teeth, his grill or something, right?
I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know. I think it's with Paul Wall and all them, and Paul Wall makes the grills and all that.
Oh, so. Okay. But yeah, that's when my brother started introducing me to more rap. He said, "Check out this guy."
Yeah. So what other rap are you into? Are you into any mainstream artists that?
Well, I'm not. I wouldn't really say I'm into learned about the different rappers. I basically, the rappers that I know of is because of my brother, right? My 22-year-old brother. He's big into rap. He knows all about it. He knows a lot more than me. So he basically educates me, and the stuff that I like is only because he's played it so many times that I can't help but like it. That's just the way I am, if something is played long enough around me, I'm gonna end up liking it. It's just an annoying thing, so
sure. Yeah.
I try to separate myself and isolate myself as much as possible, because I just sometimes I just don't want to hear. It's just too much. Like I want to focus on other things. I don't know. That's just the way I am.
Yeah.
But tell me about your family. Like, how do they respond to to your rapping and to your liberty philosophy?
They're always like mostly politically apathetic as a whole, for the most part, and they're just pretty neutral about it. They were really supportive of rapping and all that, and when I was a kid and all that. I mean, it was just the music I was around growing up. I grew up in a rural, farm town and I went to school at a really small school, but it's really super culturally diverse. And I don't know, rap music was just the music that was around, so that's why I became a rapper. And then, my path towards anarchy, it's all based in logical ideas that are pretty easy to digest if you do them slowly. So when they hear me talk about this stuff, they kind of get it, and they're pretty apathetic as a whole. But they don't. Nobody really objects to my to when I talk about it. And when I talk about things, I always try to focus on individual issues more than just general things. Like, that's why I use the word liberty rather than anarchist. When I can, and titles get people confused, and anarcho-capitalism is anarchy and capitalism are two words that people hear and are like, that's bad, It's mm-hmm. just the ideas ingrained in people's thinking. So I try to focus on ideas. I'm not really interested in arguing with people. I'm more interested in trying to assist them in believing in liberty and understanding the ideas. So, it doesn't matter whether I'm talking to a progressive or I'm talking to a mainstream Republican or I'm talking to a libertarian. There's plenty of common ground with everyone for anarchy. There's plenty of common ground. And that's how I try to talk to people. It's pretty easy.
So do you try to engage as many people as you can around wherever you are? You go to the grocery store, the bank, wherever you are.
Yeah, it's definitely what I like to talk about. So I try to talk to you about it whenever I can. It's usually just through the lens of whatever the issue of the day is. Right now it's the militarization of police or police brutality or whatever. But the real cause is the war on drugs. That's kind of the root cause. Now this is just a product, and when you explain to people most people get it. The video of Eric Garner getting choked and fucking being killed, nobody thinks that's all right. They're a super vocal minority think it's okay. Mm-hmm. Most people are like, this is nonsense. There is some horrible shit going on. When I explain to people, I just say, look, it's caused the war on drugs. See, I read an article the other day that 62% or something like that of arrests police make are for nonviolent criminals, the vast majority of which are drug-related. And it's complete nonsense to arrest someone for doing something they want to do to themselves. But beyond that, the cops, or the people enforcing the laws, are actually the root cause of most of the violence there is too, because all drug-related violence is because of prohibition. We learned a long time ago prohibition doesn't work. That's what created the crime kingpins to start with, and this is just the continuation of that. Gang violence and all that is just a product of the war on drugs, and there would be no drug kingpins if cops weren't enforcing these laws. It's like the war on drugs led to police profiteering, which has led to militarization of police, and it's just it's a racket. Just like being a drug kingpin is a racket, and both sides need each other to keep each other going. It's a perpetual cycle of just disgusting, a disgusting thing that doesn't work, and we can clearly see it doesn't work. And when I say that, people are like, "Oh, well, that kind of makes sense."
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean. Yeah, you're right. We have a perfect, a near perfect example of how prohibition is a complete failure. But I think that kind of gives politicians the benefit of being ignorant or stupid, which I don't really think that they are. I don't think that they're ignorant. I think they know exactly what they're doing, and so from that respect, the drug war is a massive success. right? It's doing exactly what they want it to do. And you know, the police, you know, brutality is just a, it's just a natural progression. It's a natural appendage to that, you know, that failed action. So, you know, of course they have to tell the people that, you know, that, you know, what's going on. You know, we need more police, we need more riot gear, we need more, you know, what's it called? The mine resistant tank vehicles, you know, on the streets. Because marijuana is just so dangerous, you know? So.
Yeah. It's crazy.
And actually, you know, I was just talking to my brother recently because, you know, talking about how much of a business, of a, you know, of a successful business a person can make through, like, for example, not even becoming a you know, a, let's say a weed dealer, but even just selling, like, untaxed cigarettes, like what the guy, you know, Eric Garner was basically killed for over, right? Untaxed cigarettes. And
yeah, like, that's a black market. Like, it has become a gray market or whatever. It's become an illegal marketplace that's worth doing because it's so profitable.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah, definitely. Like, and how, you know, my brother was telling me, you know, how it works basically is that in New York, which is the highest, basically, I think the state that has the highest tax on cigarettes, and even higher in New York City. So that's where the black market especially flourishes. And so, you know, what people do, they go down to Virginia where, you know, it's like $4 a pack, and they come back up here where it's like $10 a pack, and they sell it, and they make, you know, massive profits, and people can make like six figures just by doing that. You know, and yeah, something like that. That's what I've heard. Like, like you can really be, if you're efficient, you can be pretty profitable. And it's just a natural progression of, you know, the state trying to discourage people from doing something that is maybe just a vice. You know, it's one thing Lysander Spooner teaches, right? Vices are not crimes. Right, and that's what I try to tell people also. You know, people get this idea so confused, right? You know, but they're drug dealers, they're weed dealers.
Yeah.
You know, you're like, yeah, and what's wrong with it? You don't like it? Go ahead.
I mean, drugs and guns and even prostitution, all these things that people aren't crazy about in society, that you know, there's laws against and all this. It's the thing is, like, once a technology exists, it's never going to not exist. And if you try to make it not exist, it creates a black market, which is going to create violence to enforce, you know, rules of the market, to enforce contracts, basically. And that's always going to happen. It doesn't matter whether it's prostitution or drugs or guns or, I mean, even abortion to some extent. I know the moral solution that abortion is not good, but I don't think it can be illegal. Like, you just have to change people's minds about it, because even if it's illegal, it's still going to happen. And it's a matter of altering people's minds about it. But once the technology exists, it exists, and there's nothing, any government, any power structure, anything can do to stop it.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. Talking about, you know, 3D printers and printing guns and things like that. I'm sure that has changed massively, you know, talking about gun control laws, that's really changed the landscape. And it kind of reminded me of Larkin Rose's video. Have you seen the one where it's titled What's So Bad About Nazis? Have you seen that?
No, I don't think
that was a really great one. And he basically, in the video, he basically says, you know, he's like, this is a serious question. What is so bad about Nazis? And what is so different from the Nazis comparing them to the federal government as it is today, right? And the very first thing most people would say is, well, they killed millions of people, right? Okay, so let's see, the Native American genocide, right? Police brutality, how many people die? What was it like you're like 8 times more likely to die from a police officer than you are from a terrorist? Right?
It's higher than that, isn't it?
Is it higher? I don't even, that's the last I checked. But you know, there's really nothing at all different. Like, what is it, the sign? You don't like the sign? Is that what makes them different? Or the military, you know, the police state? Like, what, you know, Hitler would be jealous You know, if you saw the surveillance state as it is today, you know.
Oh yeah, completely. And the number of people in prison is just crazy. Like 1% of the population or something.
Yeah,
it's insane.
Something like that. Yeah,
it is more than any of the worst regimes or monarchs or you know, dictators in the history of the world. More people are in prison in the United States now than any of those places had. Or the United States has more people in prison per capita than any place.
Yeah.
Small, awful dictatorships.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like even in a country like China, you know, which has like around a billion people, you know, we still have more percentage and absolute number of people in prison than China, which is supposed to be like red communist China, you know, although now they're starting to become more capitalist. I also try to talk as often as I can to people around me about this stuff, because there's so many misconceptions that we live with all the time it's a constant job, and I like it.
Yeah,
you know.
Do you ever feel like you're forced to focus on the negative so often because it's so glaringly obvious that the regular belief that people have about any given topic is always so false? Then you're forced to say, no, that's not true all the time. You're always poking holes and stuff. And do you ever feel like I'm forced to focus on the negative because I think like this?
Like my family, for example, like I get into constant arguments with my mother, especially, and her primary thing, because you know she's all about, you know, green living and you know solar panels and all this kind of stuff. So her primary thing is, what if there's a company that pollutes, you know, and you know destroys the water, the soil, pollutes the air. What is going to happen to that company if there's no government to correct it, its actions, or to, you know, regulate it? And to which, you know, you can say, like, well, does that happen today with the government?
Exactly. There's no government for them to lobby to make laws that allow them to pollute.
Exactly. Right? Yeah. You know, I talk about, and actually I was just talking to my, another one of my relatives, and I said, you know, I started talking about there's certain corporations that are, you know, given subsidies, and which actually promotes more reckless behavior, right? So when you give a bailout, right, or a subsidy or some kind of political favoritism, you're rewarding inefficiency. You're rewarding reckless behavior. So what happens? Are you going to see less reckless behavior or more, right?
Yeah,
so exactly. That's the incentive, right? And then he's like, no, that doesn't happen. Like, what are you talking about? Let's go down the list. Chevron, Shell, BP, Chase, JP Morgan, Bank of America, you know, Monsanto, should I go on?
That's it, exactly. Every major corporation, that's what they do, and that's what they're forced to do, because that's what the marketplace requires them to do now. Because if there's a super honest company that wants to, you know, be a big bank, and then they want to compete in that field, they can't unless they lobby the government. And that's the force that we're against. What's the common denominator between big evil corporations and everything else? The common denominator is they're all in bed with the government. And between all big evil corporations and all that, it's the government. You have to get the government out of the scenario, out of the situation. And the only way to do, like, the jump I made from, you know, being a libertarian to being an anarchist was that the only things the government should be in charge of as a libertarian are security and settling of disputes or whatever, courts. You say, well, the government can't do anything, right? And there's plenty of examples and explanations of how the free market could handle those things in an anarchist environment. So you just remove them from the scenario. And the libertarian belief that, you know, a small government would be good, but you're never going to be able to keep it because the government's still there. And this is the nature of it. Whenever there's a monopoly on anything and there's no competition, it's always going to get bigger and bigger and bigger, just like the police state, just like the government has for the last 200 years. It started real small, but then it got bigger and bigger and bigger because there's nothing for it to compete against. And you know, competition makes things be efficient. Competition makes things progress. You have to advance. You have to be competitive. And the government will never do that. And that's just it.
Yeah.
They're basically economic rules here.
Yeah. You know, even if the government is like, you know, say 5% of what it is today, if it's still a government, then it still has the right, it claims the moral right to rule and to tax its citizens, right? To steal from its citizens. So if you give even a government that's just 5% of what it is today the ability to steal from its citizens, then it doesn't matter. It will swell and it will grow to gigantic proportions until it just topples over, right? Because the people can't support a giant welfare and warfare state anymore, any longer, right? It can't be leeching off the productivity of the industrious any longer.
And that's exactly what it does, is it leeches off of the productivity of everyone else. If you make a dollar a week and somebody takes a penny out of it, and it just goes, and that's 5 cents or whatever, and all it's doing is taking future productivity and future energy that could be used towards advancing further and making people's individual lives better in the most efficient way possible, and just using it in random ways that don't make sense. The invisible hand really works, and it's just people doing whatever they want to do, and that's it. And the use of force, government is nothing more than the use of force. That's it. Absolutely.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely. And you know, it's funny when people bicker about tax laws, you know, like, you know, saying, you know, we need this tax law, we need to get rid of this one, but keep this one, we need to scale this one down. So it's like, imagine let's say with what you say, you have a dollar, right? And I say, okay, I'm going to put a gun to your head and say, give me 10 cents or else I'm going to, you know, imprison you or kill you, right? So you give me 10 cents and you're like, all right, that's not so bad. But then what's to stop me from saying, all right, now give me the whole dollar?
Yeah.
Right? Because that's what a monopoly is. So the idea is not, it's not how much we're being taxed, it's the fact that we're being taxed, right? It's the theft.
Yeah.
That's the issue.
Exactly. And that's all it is. It's extortion. It's theft with the threat of being kidnapped if you don't concede to having your money taken from you. The fruits of your labor taken from you, and that's all it is. And now the arguments against it that people come up with, the social contract and all these other things, it's a good idea, but in an anarchist society, like, you can live communally, and people will live communally. There might be communal cities, and yeah, you can live in an environment where everybody gives so much of the fruits of their labor to do this and do that and do that. People are welcome to go and live these places and experiment in whatever way, and these things are going to exist. But you can't force people to do it. You can't hold, like, if you're born between these two imaginary lines on a map, you're stuck here, you know? And it's, And they're just going to continue to take your wealth, to take the fruits of your labor by force for all time, and it's just taking. That's just the way the world is, and it's completely ridiculous.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, I mean, it's true. Like, you know, let's say in a stateless society, you will have different types of people that want to live differently. Let's say, you know, some people want to live in a community where they smoke weed, right? Some people want to live in a weed-less community, you know, without weed. Some people want to live in a just black community, just white, just Hispanic, whatever, just Christian, you know? And as long as it's voluntary, what's the problem, right? People can come and go as they please, you know? What's the problem? And I think actually the same can be said for private businesses, right? If somebody wants to have a business catering only to black people or only to white people, only to Hispanic people, right? Why can't they do that, right? Why do you need a law forcing businesses to act in one way or another just because, you know, you think it's immoral?
Yeah, that's ridiculous to say that your private business is not like your house. To say that you have to let anyone in your house would be completely ridiculous. And to say that you don't own your business and you have to let anyone in your business is just like saying you have to let anyone in your house. It's completely ridiculous.
Yeah.
And obviously the businesses that are going to succeed the best are the ones that aren't prejudiced, right? Like, they're the ones that are the marketplace is going to work, and people are welcome to protest the businesses that are racist or whatever, that are prejudiced. Yeah, they can march on the side and do whatever, you know? And as long as it's nonviolent, that's fine. And that discourages people from shopping there even more. And so, like, freedom wins, and treating people good is going to win in the long run, but it can't be done with force. It has to be done naturally.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, actually, talking about protesting, I was talking about with my family about the Fergusson, rioting that's been going on recently. And and I was basically saying how idiotic it is that these looters who have no idea what they're actually protesting for. It seems like they're just taking advantage of the commotion so that they can destroy private property, steal merchandise, and it's so absurd because it's so sad that you see these entrepreneurs who are themselves black. They come out and they're just like. This is like yelling at these idiotic young kids that are stealing their stuff. Like, what the hell are you doing? I had nothing to do with this. this is my business. I built it up, over many, many years. And you're just destroying it. What the hell are you doing? You guys are morons. I was basically saying how, that's basically what it is. When you have riots and protests and, mass gatherings like that, you tend to have mobs and violence. It usually degenerates that way, right? People do not think when they're in a mob scene.
Yeah, right, because there's no individual responsibility in that situation. The kind of group thought kind of takes over in many ways. And yeah, it's really unfortunate that happened, because this is something that, people in the liberty movement focused on for a long time was the police state and police brutality and this stuff. And when this stuff has happened as of recent, and it brings so much to light and gives us an opportunity to inform people about these ideas that we've been talking about for so long, and it gets such a black eye on it because of the looting and the rioting. That's the Fox News narrative, is that there was looters and rioters. And the vast majority of people protesting were peaceful. But it was such an opportunity to spread the message of liberty, and it got such a black eye because there's all these shots of buildings burning, and it's really unfortunate.
Yeah,
because the whole right wing, the right wing talk radio and Fox News and all that's just all they focused on, and that was their message. They skipped over. They don't even talk about the police brutality part. And their defense of it is unnecessary now, because they have other reasons why those people are wrong, which sucks. But this is I don't want to say that this is a good thing that happened, but this has been an awesome opportunity for people in the liberty movement to talk about police brutality and talk about the war on drugs and talk about these things. While people are paying attention, and that's what I try to do a lot, is talk about the things people are thinking about, say in a way that's digestible to them. I try to be aware, if I'm talking to a liberal, I'll talk words that I know that are appealing to them, but I'm still talking about liberty. I just change my message a little. I mean, change the words that I'm using a little bit so it appeals to them. If I'm talking to a conservative, I'll talk in more about economics from an economic perspective. And that's what I take from Fergusson was it's really sad what happened, and an effort to try to control the narrative to towards something positive is what we should be trying to do.
Yeah, it also reminds me of a quote by Alexander Haig. I think he was the Secretary of State. He said, "Let them protest and march all they want, as long as they pay their taxes." So if people focus their efforts on going onto the street and carrying signs and just shouting something, but then afterwards they just go back to doing what they were doing before, what did you achieve, right? So that's, and also the other thing is, when you protest, it's kind of a dangerous thing, right? You're like attracting police, right? Riot police in riot gear, right? You're basically attracting violence. And so that's one of the reasons why I kind of discourage people from protesting. I don't recommend it. It's not my first method of spreading a message, you know. Like, in this day and age with the internet, there's so many ways to spread a message. Like, you're spreading a message with, you know, with rap, right? You can spread it through YouTube, you can spread it through the Facebook, through, you know, through so many ways. Why are you going to go and put yourself in harm's way, you know, for holding up a sign? It just doesn't make sense to me anymore.
Yeah. Protesting and marching today, like the Ferguson and the Obama, this is like an outlier, right? There's protests that happen every day, especially in like D.C. and all around the country. People march and protest all the time, and you never hear about any of it. This is just the one time that it happened to get media attention. And there's I think to each their own. As long as you do what you think is best to spread the message that you want to spread, but yeah, there's much more efficient ways of doing it. But I think everybody just needs to do what's right for them, too. So.
Yeah, quite right, definitely. I mean, if you really, really want to protest, I mean, go ahead, but understand what you're doing. Like, I'm sure you've seen those, the Adam Kokesh, and also Peter Schiff did also some videos where he actually went to some of these protests, gatherings, Occupy Wall Street, like the Monsanto. I think Christopher Cantwell did also. And he's basically just asking them simple questions like, what is the Federal Reserve? Do you know what a Federal Reserve note is? You know? Yeah. And they have no idea what that is. Like, what do you even put? What is capitalism? They can't even answer that question. So what are you doing out here then?
Yeah. People have been talking about the big three recent, you know, political uprisings or whatever. And it was the Tea Party, and it was Ferguson, it was Occupy Wall Street, and I think Anonymous is actually the fourth too, but it's done in a different way. Mm-hmm. And Anonymous is that happened online for the most part.
Yeah.
The symbology went into the other protests and stuff. But as a whole, like, that has progressed to become a very, you know, liberty-minded thing, Anonymous as a whole,
yeah,
for most of the stuff that they do. And that has actually grown and got better as time went on. But these other things that started with something good, that was something liberty-minded, like the Tea Party, like, I was at one in 2007, you know? Mm-hmm. And it was all about liberty. And now it's just become something awful and disgusting. And Occupy Wall Street was good energy towards, you know, banks and better government is the problem. But they're focusing on the banks rather than the government, rather than the Federal Reserve, which is unfortunate. And this, the Ferguson thing, is turning, focusing more on race. While there is definitely a racial outcome to the war on drugs, but the war on drugs is the cause. It's not, like, I don't think cops are intentionally racist, but the laws are enforcing or encouraging them to be. And it's probably, again, it's just getting diverted into the wrong direction. And this is the group thing. Like, people just want to chant stuff that doesn't really have any rational logic behind it. And then it dies off because there's really no thought behind it. But that's why I try to spread the message. Spread the end of the war on drugs. That's not something people are going to forget. People see that every day. Every day when you get pulled over, when your car gets searched. I've been pulled over in my car searched so many times. Let's see, war on drugs. Like, I'm not heard. I've never been suspected of harming anyone, but I've been suspected of many victimless crimes. So,
like when I see people, you know, march on Monsanto or the Occupy Wall Street, or, you know, protesting Chevron, you know, the oil, destroying the Amazon rainforest in South America. These are all horrible companies and corporations. You know, it's true, but you know, you're just. It's like you're just trying to, fight the Hydra head, you know, or you're trying to fight a branch, you know. You have to go to the root, right? You're not going to the root. And if so many people could just focus their attention on the root, I think it would just be amazing what we could achieve.
Yeah, it's whack-a-mole, right? You know, if you destroy Monsanto, another Monsanto is just going to rise up. Mm-hmm. You have to destroy what's feeding Monsanto.
Oh, yeah. What gives it teeth? What gives it sovereign immunity, you know, to do what it does with impunity, right? You have the Monsanto Protection Act, which completely protects it from any litigation from people who claim to be injured by GMO seeds. And you know, that's amazing. Like, imagine a small business, you know, any small business that has no ties to the government. If they go under, that's it. They go under. They don't get a bailout. Right?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm interested to ask you this, to relate to what we were talking about earlier. Obviously, the worst part about GMOs is the idea of making living things intellectual property, right? To make genes and stuff intellectual property. What are your thoughts? Do you think this is technology that should not exist? I think you can't stop it. I just think, you know, just like any other technology, it's going to exist, going to continue to exist. But I think, you know, just the laws protecting it and defending it are insane, and it being intellectual property are completely crazy.
Yeah. I just wrote an article recently called, I titled it, GMOs are to food what Keynesianism is to economics.
So, yeah, I checked that out.
Yeah, so what I, you know, so, being an anarchist, right, I cannot be for any kind of ban, right, because that would basically just enlarge state power, be completely contrary to what I'm striving for as an anarchist. So, you know, I give all of the power to the free market to decide whether or not they want GMOs. And it just seems to me that, you know, given all the farm subsidies and protection that these giant corporations get, I just don't see something like GMOs persisting and surviving at all. You know, I may be wrong, but that's just the way I think will happen. You know, of course, you know, I don't advocate any violence happening one way or another. I think the people will decide, and without a state, we will inevitably have technology that will foster life. You know, because that's what happens with, you know, when you remove the violence of government, you automatically have corporations that are environmentally friendly and that do conserve resources. They have to, because, you know.
Yeah. Do you think it's possible for GMOs to foster life? Do you think genetic modification could be good in the long run?
I mean, it's. I think it's kind of ridiculous to even ponder if it will or will not. I just basically leave it up to the people to decide. You know, if they want it, they're gonna support it. They're gonna buy it, right? If it ends up, let's say, you know, government dissolves, right, and you know spontaneously, and there is no more government subsidies or protectionism. If these genetically modified foods are found to be indeed carcinogenic and basically just, you know, destroy life and, you know, cause genetic mutations in offspring, then, you know, it's going to be obvious what's going to happen, right? So I don't think that it's even necessary to think about, like, what would happen, or should I, you know, should it exist or should it not exist. It's like, it will take care of itself. You know, I like George Carlin's view about environmentalism. You know, he's like, basically, it's so ridiculous how we try to, you know, save the whale, save the snail, save the bee, save the all this stuff, right? Because, you know, because humans have caused global warming, right? And we are the evil of the earth, and we, you know, we've caused the extinction of so many species. But, you know, look at how many species have already been extinct. 99.9% of species already extinct. That had nothing to do with humans. You know?
Yeah, I don't know. Absolutely.
That's so true.
That's so true. I think that's the way. I think messing with genetics is definitely going to become more and more prevalent and advance more and more and more. And I have high hopes that just like any other technology, eventually it's going to make life better. But again, I don't know when the marketplace will handle it. You talk about George Carlin. I'm a big fan of comedy myself. You talk about your brother who likes comedy a lot too. My favorite comedian is probably Doug Stanhope, like, obviously, because, you know, he's pretty liberty-minded guy.
Yeah.
What are some other comedians that you're into?
Yeah, like Doug Stanhope, like Bill Burr is actually a little bit liberty-minded. He speaks his mind pretty well. Cat Williams occasionally. And then there's, so you have George Carlin and then Bill Hicks. Bill Hicks is really awesome. In terms of liberty, you know, he's kind of unfortunately died so young, 32 years old, I think he died. But there's not many though, you know, liberty, and also there's this guy Steve Hughes. He's pretty awesome. Yeah, he's a British comedian. But yeah, there's not too many. And
I'm gonna write.
Yeah, I'll give you the I'll give you these names afterwards. I'll definitely send you some videos. There's some awesome people. If you can spread liberty in whatever is your profession, whatever thing that you're skilled at, all the better, right? So
and if you can laugh while doing it, it makes it a lot better.
Oh, definitely. That's the way I prefer to spread my message, is through laughter. It reminds me of a great Oscar Wilde quote. He said, if you want to share some truth, make the people laugh, or else they're going to kill you.
Right? Yeah, that's probably wise. Yeah, that's definitely wise. I like that. I like that a lot.
Humor is very important. Oh yeah, so important. So, that's my goal. Whenever I'm talking to people about this stuff, it's so important to get people to laugh, because you automatically have broken down the barriers. And they're not defensive anymore, and they're more receptive and open to your ideas. So,
yeah, completely. Speaking to people's interests is always the way to go.
Yeah,
yeah. Especially when you're talking about economics and stuff that's kind of hard to digest. You have to put it in fun ways and make fun metaphors and they say when you're giving a speech or something, you need to laugh every 30 seconds or 60 seconds or something. To maintain people's interest.
You mean if you can get the audience to laugh?
Yeah, definitely.
Comedy. I used to do stand up comedy for like a year. And I did it for about a year. Like performed in Manhattan, a couple of clubs there, and some clubs in Long Island. And it really helps. Public speaking is something that's so deficient in so many people. I talk to people, and everybody says that. I can't do comedy because I'm a horrible public speaker. But you know what? Who is not? Everybody is a horrible public speaker. It's a skill that you have to develop. And I remember seeing a poll that said, "What is the thing that people are most afraid of?" Right, and number one is public speaking. Number two is death.
Really?
Yeah.
That's
crazy. Yeah. So,
what was the method for that poll? Did they just ask people and they said public speaking, more often than they said death?
I don't know, but I remember. That's what I remember, and it really caught my interest, because it is a very it's primary thing in people's minds. Like, I can't do that. That's not for me. I'm not funny. I'm not a funny person. So it's something that everybody can develop, and it just enhances your communication skills, how you can deliver a message, right? So,
it's
just another way. But I don't want to keep you too long. So let people know how they can reach you. Any websites or Facebook page or anything like that.
Sure. The best way to follow me, I encourage just to follow me on Twitter. It's at MAMO. N1LH. That's Mamo and the letter N, the number one, the letter L, the letter H. And that stands for No One Leaves Hungry, which is kind of my rap conglomerate that I was part of. Find me on Facebook. I'd love to talk about stuff and keep the ideas going. I just make some more on Facebook.
Any YouTube channels?
There's links to all my other social media through there. You can find me on YouTube. Just search me.
Mm-hmm. Awesome.
My Google Plus is just Mason Moore, and my YouTube channel is Mason Moore. My music videos on there, all that stuff. So, check it out, share it, download it, steal it, claim it your own, do whatever.
Awesome. No IP, right? No IP.
No IP whatsoever. Steal it. Record it and claim it your own. It's all good. All good.
If you want to finish off with a message, any message you want to give to the listeners before we go?
Understand that most people, 98% of the population are not psychopaths, and they really just want what's best and they want to be happy. So just have empathy when you're talking to people about ideas, and be gentle when talking to them, and speak to their interests, and promote the ideas of liberty, because it'll make the world a better place.
Nice. Yep, I completely agree. Awesome. All right.
Thanks
very cool.
So much, man.
Mason, thanks for the opportunity. So this is Peaceful Anarchism on the Voluntary Virtues Network and the Conscious Resistance. Wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care. Bye.